as he intercedes for us, his church, he is waiting. And our Savior himself is going to stand up. He's going to empty heaven of every angel, every saint. He's going to come back and finish the plan because God is watching over his word to perform it. And when he does, this event that occurs is emerging. In fact, I like to put it this way. The day of the Lord's second coming kind of puts those Old and New Testament ideas together. And what we're looking at this morning is the day of the Lord's second coming. And when the inheritor of everything and the creator of everything, as we saw last week, and the radiator of God's glory, and the one who is the representation of God sustaining everything, who purified our sins, when he comes as the ruler of everything, the universe, as we'll see this morning, it's like a cosmic earthquake. Now, that's kind of an oxymoron because an earthquake is localized to the earth quaking, but it's like more than the earthquakes. It's a cosmic event when the Creator comes back in wrath. And as Christ comes, the earth begins to quake. Every human with sin staining their lives starts crawling for cover. In fact, it's amazing how the Old Testament prophets talk about, in detail, about how the moles and the creeping things are going to be pushed out as humans burrow into the ground to escape, as if it were possible. God stepping onto the stage of human events. Well, just to understand some key terms for a moment, remember the various ways God has chosen to describe the terminal event for earth dwellers. In a key passage, Daniel 9, we see God explains the end of days for earth as a buildup over 7 years. Now, the Bible describes the whole 7 years, and I'm going to kind of help you see a little panorama this morning of that time. The 7 years is divided by God's word into various subdivisions. So, basically, what we see, it's a seven-year period. You ever heard of the seven-year tribulation? Where that comes from is Daniel 9, 27a, and highlighted at the bottom is what Daniel says. Then he shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week. And the he is the future ruler of Rome. And the covenant is with Israel. And he solves the Arab-Israeli problem better than John Kerry ever could try to, or Hillary tried to, and Clinton tried. Everybody's tried to solve it, but this man will. None of these other agreements are going to work because there's going to be a lingering, smoldering problem till the Antichrist comes. So that's the seven-year part. Now, what's interesting is the 7 years, in verse 27, it says, but in the middle of the week. The week is 7 years. The middle of it is 3.5 years. So in God's way of looking at the future, God sees 7 years divided into two distinct parts. And the middle of it is the breaking of the covenant that the future ruler of the revived Roman Empire breaks that he made with Israel. So that's the midpoint. In the middle of the week, he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering. At the midpoint of what we call the tribulation, for the first 3.5 years, the Jews are astonishingly allowed to build a temple and to start sacrificing animals. And they're just in their glory. They can't believe that the world's accepted them. And then he breaks that covenant. Well, the next element is that the doctrine of the second coming encompasses the events of the tribulation. It's also called in the Old Testament the day of the Lord. It's called in Daniel the 7 years. It's also called 42 plus 42 months. See, it's the math of the future is that there's a 7 year period that's 3.5 and 3.5 years, or it's called 42 months and 42 months, or it's called 1,260 days and 1,260 days. It's kind of like saying a dollar or four quarters or 100 cents. You understand, it's the same thing, just measured in different ways. And so what we see is the day of the Lord is the day of the Lord who returns. And what is that that fills the pages of Scripture is a warning to all sinners to repent while there's time. And what happens if they don't? Well, let's just take a moment to think about Revelation 6. And if you look down your Bible, starting in verse 12, I want to show you and show you the chronology of what's going to happen. I'll do that with a graphic and try and represent this. But basically, the clearest picture comes when we merge the Old Testament understanding of the 7 years of Israel's troubles and the midpoint and the Antichrist, and then using that as a grid, place in the events that Revelation talks about. So here they are. And first of all, the white seal. Do you remember that? That's verses 1 and 2 of chapter 6. It's the white horse and rider of global deception, false peace and prosperity, the rise of the Superman called the Antichrist. And basically, as we saw last time, it's when God gives everybody what they always wanted. They always wanted this superhuman that they could see that was just like them and that they could worship and touch and just put all their hope in. And that's why he conquers so rapidly the world, because he's kind of like the expected one. And everybody will like him on their social media, and everybody will follow him. And that's the first. Well, second is the red horse. And that's the red horse and rider of warfare and killing in verses 3 and 4. And God gives humans up, as we saw last time, to be what our lusts and sinful hearts want, and that's our own way, which leads to murder, to warfare, and to death from fighting. And then comes the black horse, that third seal, and that's the spread of famine and scarcity, and God allows the earth to begin to not be such a hospitable place for humanity, which leads to the pale green horse, the final horseman of the apocalypse in verses 7 and 8. And that's a horrific duo of death and Hades. And when Christ is rejected, his spirit is restrained, when God the Father Almighty is unwanted all across the world, warfare and famine of the second and third seals, plus the addition of pestilences and plagues in this fourth seal, leads to, before any wrath of God, one out of every four humans dies in war, murdered, starves to death, or has a horrific pestilence that takes them down. It's a very sobering time. Well, then we come to the fifth seal. And the fifth seal is when the prayer of the martyrs is unleashed. Just as our prayers for God's kingdom to come are going to be reflected in his wrath during the tribulation, here we see those who have been slain. During this peace and prosperity, warfare and famine and plagues and pestilence and death period, an uncountable multitude of people get saved. Probably the single greatest ingathering of humans to salvation in all of history. It's just amazing to think of that. And those are slain for their witness for Christ, and those martyrs are huddled under the throne, and God powerfully responds to their prayer, and the prayers break forth in the next seal. Now, I want you to think about what happens with this sixth seal and what God does. As if a global dictator and global wars and global famines and global pestilences and death were not enough, now God's wrath. It's almost like the proverbial, you know, the kids keep doing, and the parent keeps watching and watching, and finally they respond. Now, the wrath of man works not the righteousness of God, but the wrath of God works the justice and righteousness of God. And that's what we're seeing here. And all the trouble of the tribulation so far, a fourth of all humans die in the first half, were generated by humans. But now, with the sixth seal, we get a little taste. The beginning, it's kind of like the appetizer. Now, amazing. If this is the appetizer, can you imagine what the meal is going to be like? In fact, Revelation 19 calls the crescendo of the tribulation as it culminates in Armageddon, the great supper of God. It's like the great outpouring where he is providing people to be consumed by the birds of the air as they're killed. Well, Revelation 6, 12 to 17 is the sixth seal, and within this seal, John describes six succeeding disasters that strike the earth. And we're at the midpoint. You can see there the center point that God designated. This chart is not kind of imaginative. It's just the literal events that God talks about. He talks about the beginning and the midpoint and the horrors of the midpoint. And this is when God steps in at the center. Well, in verse 12, after the wars that ravaged humanity, after the false promises of the Antichrist that seduced humanity away from the true gospel, seal number 6 is the shaking of the earth. And so when God shakes the earth, what happens? What happens when God steps back on the stage? When the Creator that no one ever saw, when the Redeemer that few ever acknowledged, when he comes back onto the stage, the earth begins to shake. Everything that humans have experienced for those 42 months of Revelation 6, verses 1 through 11, have been mostly self-induced. The first 5 seals chronicled the natural consequences of sinful humanity's evil ways. Those consequences were magnified because of the control rods of the Spirit's restraint and the church's presence were removed. But the hand of God begins to take place.